We have seen what the elements of models are. Now we will turn to the mechanisms or operations that we use in order to actually build models. There are three basic modeling operations. To declare the properties of a class, we've seen examples of that already, and this is called attribution. To declare which classes an object belongs to, instantiation or classification. And to declare subclasses of a given class, this is called specialization or generalization. Everything we need to know must be declared. Otherwise, it would be impossible for a machine to understand that, because remember, a model has to be understandable by both men and machines. The assignment of properties, that is attribution, we have already talked about. So let us turn to the mechanism called instantiation or classification now. And it is an is of type or member of set declaration. Take the very simple example, depiction depicts figure. We have the entity class depiction and the relation depicts, and the range of the relation depicts is figure. Now, if we take any particular depiction, such as this depiction that depicts Theofanti, we actually have three instantiations taking place here. That is, the declaration that this depiction is in fact a depiction, the declaration that Theofanti is an instance of figure, and the declaration that the association between this depiction and Theofanti is an instance of the relation depicts. In terms of notation, we write down Theofanti in figure or Theofanti instance of figure, and in the RDF language, we write Theofanti RDF colon type figure. In this example, we have the class person with a number of properties assigned to it. On the right, we see the properties name, surname, weight, and has age. Note that name and surname are properties having range string, because we can use strings to denote a name or a surname. Note that the attribute weight is in fact what we call a composite attribute. You see that to quote the weight, we need to give the measure, which will be a real number, and the unit of measurement. So weight is actually an entity class which has to consist of a number and a unit of measurement for weights. And of course, the same we would have done for any other kind of measurement, such as height, temperature, etc. There is the property birth with range date, and the property has age with range age. And then on the left, we have two other properties, mother and father. Note that because the mother of a person is a person too, and the father of a person is also a person, the domain and range of the mother and father properties are both the same class, person, and so this is represented by an arrow emanating from and coming back to the same entity. This is sometimes called a self-association. Now, so far, we have shown a larger example than before of attribution. We have person with a number of attributes assigned to it. Now, if we instantiate each of those, we get what we have at the bottom of the picture. We have an entity PC, which is an instance of person, that has mother, another entity Anna, and father, another entity Christos. The name of PC is Panos, the surname is Konstantopoulos, and then we have the weight and the date of birth of this person. And you may note that we have not instantiated the has age, not because it is so hard to find out what my age is, but rather because I want to show that when we instantiate an entity, it is not necessary to instantiate all properties. Remember the cardinality constraints. We have to instantiate certain properties, but if we don't have to, if they are optional, we just can instantiate an entity, so it is there, we declare its existence, and we also declare whatever knowledge we have about it by instantiating the appropriate properties. So in this figure, we have a schema at the top and instances at the bottom, with every single item at the bottom being an instance of the corresponding item at the top. Now, why is classification important? To answer this, perhaps we have to reformulate the question a little bit. What is the use of classes? What do we use classes for? A class is a set of objects that are similar by some criterion, as we've already said. Now, such criteria could be the nature of the object, so it is a pine tree or an elephant or a car, and this is pretty much fixed given an object. It is, if it's a car, it's a car. Or it may be a function or role that the object plays, so it may be a pot or a roller gear or an earring. We may form a class based on the criterion of appearance, and therefore we have classes such as cylinder or tapered or red because of the shape or the color. Or yet we may define classes on the basis of material such as clay or steel or wood. So the classes are different ways of grouping together instances, and these groupings are determined by the use of the information we want to make. So in fact, the criteria for forming these groupings are dictated by the use of information. Each class is assigned a number of properties, and these properties serve then as a template for describing instances of the class by assigning values to those properties, instantiating the properties. So as we saw before, person was given a number of properties, and then instantiating those properties gives the description of the person PC. Now, an instance need not be an instance of a single class, like PC we showed before was an instance of person. An instance can be an instance of more than one classes, because we describe it from multiple perspectives or views, and this we call multiple instantiation. So, for example, Lekythos number 1055 can be classified as a Lekythos, but it can also be classified as a red object or as a clay object. Panos Konstantopoulos can be classified as a computer scientist or as a professor or as a swimmer. As a computer scientist, Panos Konstantopoulos may be described by quoting his specialty, and the range here will be an area of computer science. As a professor, the descriptive property might be the affiliation, that is this, the university. And as a swimmer, the distance that the person swims, so a range that the swimmer does. So taking the particular instance, we say that we have an entity that is an instance of all three classes, and because this instance belongs to each of these classes, it can be described with a property that is inherited from each of these classes. So the usefulness of multiple instantiation is that it allows us to determine different points of view. From each point of view, there is a limited number, controllable number of properties that we need in order to give a description. And then by quoting that an item is instance of more than one classes, we have at hand many, many properties, you know, some coming from each point of view, that all of them combined give us a complete description of this item. The third operation or mechanism that we are considering is specialization or generalization. This is a mechanism that declares a subclass of or subset, and it is better explained through an example. Consider the class pot and consider the class physical object. It is clear that every pot is a physical object, so the set pot is a subset of the set physical object, by definition. In terms of classes, we will say that the class pot is a subclass of the physical object class. Now, because subclass of or specialization has the meaning of subset, as we said before, the subclass pot inherits all the properties that may be defined at the superclass, physical object. So if physical object is described by the properties size, color, and weight, then this means that every pot also can be described by the size, color, and weight properties. And since we have declared that pot is subclass of physical object, there is no need to declare the properties size, color, and weight on the class pot. On the contrary, a pot may also have its own properties that not every physical object has. So for instance, for pots, we may want to say what the decoration they bear is and whether they are they have a wide neck or a narrow neck or a long neck or a short neck. So the decoration and the neck may be descriptive properties for pots, but only pots, not for all physical objects. So here we have properties that distinguish the subclass from the superclass, and therefore the superclass has the three properties size, color, and weight, whereas the subclass has the inherited properties size, color, and weight, and the local properties decoration and neck. Here we have a big economy of in notation and in the work we have to do in order to declare the model, because by using the single statement subclass of, we don't have to restate the fact that pot has all the properties that are inherited from the superclass. And you can imagine that if we have a long series of subclass of relations, and this is in fact is the case when we have hierarchies, there is a lot of inherited properties that come down from superclasses to subclasses, and doing this through the subclass of mechanism, that is the specialization mechanism, allows us to avoid mistakes in or omissions in declaring properties. So there is an economy both in terms of work, but also in terms of mistakes. In the example shown in the figure here, we show the subclass of relation between pot and physical object, and we show the inheritance mechanism at work by showing a particular pot, pot 1055, and five properties describing it. So it has size 65 centimeters, color red, weighs 2 kilos, it bears a geometric decoration, and it has a wide neck. As we said before, subclasses inherit properties and have their own properties. So let's take a closer look at how subclasses actually arise. Subclasses are characterized by additional properties. This is the case of giving extra properties. They can also be characterized by restricting the range of properties of a superclass. So take, for instance, the example of person. There may be a number of properties describing person that I even don't care to show here. I just indicate with a number of arrows. And I just single out the has age property. And then suppose that we need to consider the subclass of persons that are scientists and another subclass of persons that are athletes. If a person is a scientist, then an additional information about that person might be the scientific specialty or the discipline that the scientist specializes in. And if the person is an athlete, then we may ask, what is the sport that this athlete exercises? So all scientists may be further described by the specialty property, and all athletes may be further described by the exercises property. This way of producing subclasses is the way of adding local properties. But then now take the example of the class minor declared as a subclass of person. We know that minors are persons below a certain age. So the subclass minor is all those people that have age between 0 and 18. Now in this case, the subclass minor was defined not by attributing an additional property, but by restricting the range of the age property to a particular subrange, 0 to 18 years. So we have those two main ways of producing subclasses, by attributing additional local properties or by restricting the range of a property of the superclass. When we look at this subclass of relation going from the superclass to the subclass, we say that the subclass specializes the superclass, so this is why we call it specialization. When we look at it the other way around, we say that the superclass generalizes the subclass, we call it generalization. Now, it is clear that a class may have more than one subclasses. We have seen it in the examples before, so it can be specialized by many classes. What also happens is that a class may have more than one superclasses, which we call multiple generalization. Now, let us look at an example. Suppose we have again the class person, and that we have defined the subclasses scientist and athlete, scientist with the local property specialty, athlete with the local property exercises, to distinguish them from the common superclass person. And then suppose now that by the criterion of the specialty, we decide to declare some specific subsets of scientists, such as archaeologists. Why? Because perhaps we need to have a register of those persons, or to have, you know, some sort of information management about a particular specialty or professional group. So we define the class archaeologist, which means here are all the scientists that have specialty archaeology. And athlete, we can similarly define various subclasses of athlete depending on the sport. So scuba diver is such a subclass of athlete. It is all the athletes that are exercise scuba diving. Now, if for some reason we want to consider submarine archaeologists, this is a group of persons that are both archaeologists and scuba divers, and we can declare this by declaring a class submarine archaeologist, subclass of archaeologist, and subclass of scuba diver. What does that mean? It means that the class submarine archaeologist is the set of items, the set of entities, that have all the properties of archaeologists and all the properties of scuba divers. Specialization is a very powerful mechanism because it allows us to produce hierarchies. And it is in fact a practice that has been exercised since the ancient times to organize human knowledge in hierarchies. So take the example of the zoological taxonomy, which is clearly a hierarchy. In this picture, we show an excerpt from this hierarchy. So you see that the subclass of operation allows us to create a taxonomic hierarchy or taxonomy, which in this particular case also happens to be what we call a single hierarchy. A single hierarchy means that every class can have at most one superclass. But of course, a class can have many subclasses.